The message I have for you guys today was actually written probably about 7 years ago. Well, maybe five. Sometimes in the worst of our lives, we have some of the hardest questions that we like to ask. And, you know, you've heard Jimmy refer about my prison time and stuff. And there was one question at the beginning of that term that kept popping up in my mind. And I also heard other people asking a lot of it. That question is, if God is such a loving God, why didn't he just do away with Satan from the beginning? And that just overran my heart all over. So, since we have a loving and caring and kind God, and he loves to set our hearts at peace, he answered that question for me one day in Bible study at church. And hopefully I can deliver this message to you today. I've only done it once before, and it's never took me less than an hour. So I'm going to try to push through it a little bit today. So we'll get started. My wife was really grateful and helped me put a PowerPoint together on this. So hopefully it works out real good. So whenever you're ready, Ruth, we'll start with the first slide. It's a circle with a G in it. The G stands for God. God is beyond our wisdom. It's hard to wrap our mind around God. And when you think about the attributes of God, you can think about his omnipresence, God being everywhere all at once. He's all-knowing. He sees, he knows everything that we think, everything that we go through. From the beginning of time to the end of time, he knows it all. There isn't anything that God doesn't know. He's all-seeing. He sits on his throne, and he sees everything. Some of y'all know my friend Marion. One time she wrote up this list of God's attributes. I think she came up with 64 out of her study. And she said that's not even a top of it. And I've been able to save this, and we refer back to it every once in a while. But God is vast, and he's big. And that's what the circle represents. And what you're going to see here today is a timeline. This is a chronological timeline of how things started to come together. We're going to look at the path of man, and we're going to look at where it took us. Let's go to the next slide. So the first one is God's creation, Genesis chapter 1. God says that in 6 days the Lord made heavens and the earth, the sea and all that was in them, and he rested on the seventh day. God said, let there be light, and there was. When you get down to Genesis 1:31, after he created man and woman, he said everything was very good. Now, I don't know when God created the angels. Some people believe he created them before creation. Some people think that he created them within the 6 days. And it's possible either way. The Bible doesn't really say. But at some point in time, the angels were created. And if God says here that everything is very good, then Satan did not exist at this time. So, we'll move on. So then we come to man. Genesis chapter 2 is the creation of man. It's God put man in motion. When you look at in Genesis chapter 2, verse 15 to 20, it says, then the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to tend it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat. But of the tree of knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. And the Lord God said, it is not good that man be alone. I will make him a helper comparable to him. Out of the ground the Lord God formed man, formed every beast of the field and every bird of the air, and brought them in to Adam to see that he, to see what he would call them. And whatever Adam called each living creature, that was its name. So Adam gave names to all the cattle, to the birds of the air, and to every beast of the field. But for Adam there was not found a helper. And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to come on Adam, took a rib out of him, and he formed a woman. And that's what woman means, is after man. And God set him in the garden to tend it, to keep it, to take care of it. And that's what they did. God put him in motion. He gave him purpose. He gave him a task. He gave him everything. So we're going to move on. We're going to go to the next slide. I'm pushing through the first part of this because I want to spend a lot more time on the end of it. This enters the enemy. You've heard me talk about this before. In Ezekiel 28, it talks about God setting Lucifer in the garden. He was in the garden with them. Isaiah chapter 14 talks about the fall of Lucifer. And we're going to get into that a little bit more depth lately. But this is where Lucifer decides that he wants to be God. And he's in the garden already. And he rebels against God. And we've discussed that. Lucifer goes to Eve. When you look at Lucifer, I know I said when he goes to you, but I want to back up for a second. When you look at Lucifer, the statement I made about him in this writing, it says, this beautiful creation that God set in the garden was found with iniquity and full of rebellion. In five ways, Lucifer tried to exalt himself. In the first one, he ascended to heaven. He says, I will exalt to my throne. I will sit on the mount. I will ascend above the clouds, and I will be like the Most High. God created something beautiful. Something beautiful decided to rebel against God. That something beautiful became something very ugly. And next we go to chapter 3. This represents the fall of man. When you look at what Lucifer did that day, he went into Eve. Now we can give Eve all the grief we want. What happened that day. But there's one thing I know for sure that I've learned. When you have revelation knowledge and it comes straight from God to you, it's harder to push you off of it. But when your knowledge comes from man and you have head knowledge and it hasn't made it to your heart yet, you're easily swayed. Now, I'm not going to say that what Adam had talked to Eve about and told her and expressed to her what God expressed to him. I'm not going to say that it didn't go to her heart. I'm just going to say that it was easier for Satan to persuade Eve than it was Adam. Even though the Bible does say that Adam was right there with her. He didn't jump up and stop her. He let it go on. He didn't intervene like he should have. And this is where they got Eve to take from the forbidden fruit. Every one of us has been here. Every one of us at some point in our time has rebelled against God. Every one of us experienced this fall. Every one of us are on this track. We don't know what it was like to be in the garden. We know what it's like when we read the Bible. But we know what it means to fall. So now we're going to go down to the next one, and this is where our journey begins. When God realized what happened in the garden, he put a plan in motion. And he started to put things in place. He knew at that point that there was no way that man was going to be able to save himself. He knew at some point in time he was going to have to manifest himself. So when you look at that big letter A, that's the call of Abraham out of Ur. That's the beginning of the Israelites. I only want to bring you here because when you go to the next slide, we're going to spend a little time here. Genesis 11 through 37, that's the path between Abraham and Jacob. That's the beginning of God's plan to move toward the cross. Okay. So go ahead and go to the next slide, man. If you open your Bibles with me, you can go to Job chapter 1. If you look at where Job actually falls into the story, a lot of teachers, a lot of scholars will place Job right in between, somewhere in between the Tower of Babel and before God called out to Ur. Sometimes they move it into the middle someplace. But somewhere in this time frame of time, Job was on the earth. The Bible says that he was a righteous man. In verse 1, it says, there was a man in the land of Uz. His name was Job. And that man was blameless and upright, and one who feared God and shunned evil. And 7 sons and 3 daughters were born to him. Also his possessions were 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 female donkeys, and a very large household, so that this man was the greatest of all the people of the East. This was a man of God. This is a man that believed God, feared God, walked with God. His whole life was centered on God. There was no unrighteousness in him. He says it's a righteous man. But there was a meeting that took place in heaven. And I want to say Job is ignorant of this meeting. He doesn't know what's going on. When you jump down to verse 6, it says, now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them. And the Lord said to Satan, from where do you come? So Satan answered the Lord and said, from going to and fro on the earth and from walking back and forth on it. And then the Lord said to Satan, have you considered my servant Job, that there was none upright in him, none like him on the earth, and blameless and upright man, one who fears God and shuns evil? So we learned a little bit here because the Lord is there. Satan's there. We know it wasn't on earth because Satan came to and fro from walking on earth. The sons of God were there. There's a lot of people that don't believe this, but I believe that the sons of God, they're pointing to the angels in heaven. And so we know it took place in heaven. We know that God offered up Job to Satan. At this point, Satan takes away everything Job has. He loses his family, he loses all of his belongings, his house, everything in one day. And Satan makes an accusation here. And that accusation is very important. So Satan answered the Lord and said, does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not made a hedge around him, around his household, and around all that he has on every side? You have blessed the work of his hands, and his possessions have increased in the land, but now stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and he will surely curse you to your face. The accusation that Job makes here, or that Satan makes here, he says, does God fear, or does Job fear God for nothing? Brings an accusation against the character of God. It's very powerful. Because you got all the sons of God watching. If God does away with Satan right then and there, God becomes a tyrant in their eyes. They worship him out of fear. And that's not the character of God. So the answer to our question comes in the middle of their story. If I bring an accusation against your character, you can tell me all day long it's not true, but until it's proved, it doesn't mean anything. This struck me very right to the core when I was first beginning my walk with the Lord. I started to, for the first time, to understand the track that man has been down. We've gone from a position of being made perfect to a position where that perfect creation that God made rebelled against God and fell. And then God set his plan in motion when he called out Abraham out. And then we see Satan come into the picture. He tempts Eve. Man falls. He goes to Job. Gets Job. He loses it. Two meetings in heaven over Job. One took away all of his possessions. The other one took away all of his health. And in the scriptures it says not once did Job sin against God and curse him. Didn't say Job didn't complain a little bit. Didn't say Job didn't ask some questions or ask why. Because when you read the book of Job, you'll see it. But not once did Job ever raise his voice and curse God. So Satan took something away from Adam and Eve that was very precious. And that was the authority that God gave them over creation. It was transferred. They lost it. So now God's on the mission. And he's trying to put it back. Put in a plan. So now we're going to move on. This is man's dilemma when you look at this screen right here. When you look at the path to God, it was interrupted. There's no way for man to reach it. We've got all these religions in the world that try to reach up to God in some way, some shape, some form. And we never make it. Our path leads right straight into hell. Without any intervention, man is lost. That's the state we live in without God. And God created this world. He created everything in it. He loves this world. He loves the people in it. Satan didn't create anything. He rebelled against God. Takes everything God created and he tries he corrupts it, taints it, destroys it. So we need help. If we're ever brought back to God, we need his help. Go ahead. So now we got the four Gospels. Now we got Jesus on the picture. There was a lot that went on here when Jesus came on. You can look through the Bible and look at all the prophecies that the prophets have taught. When you look at the birth of Christ, he came as a babe in the manger. He didn't come as a conquering king. He came humble. And this is when he first came into the picture. I mean, we can go through the four Gospels, and we can learn about the life of Jesus. We can learn how he conducted himself, how he conducted his ministry, how he talked to people. We can learn a lot from him. The Bible tells us we're supposed to imitate him. We're supposed to walk with him. What I want to talk about here, let's go on to the next slide, this one. This is Christ. This is a picture of what was going on. You have two spiritual beings headed in two different directions, one volunteering to come down to humble himself. It says right there, Christ did not consider himself to be equal to God, making himself no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant, come in the likeness of man, was obedient all the way to the cross. It comes out of Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 through 11. And then you got another being that says, I will ascend to heaven, I will exalt my throne, I will sit on the mount of the congregation, and I will ascend above the clouds. I will be like the Most High. You got one being trying to make himself equal to God. The other being is God, taking the form of a man and humbling himself as lowest to a bondservant. In those days, a bondservant was the lowest form of life. It was the lowest form of slavery that you could be on. Go ahead and go to the next slide here. Then comes to the cross. As you see there, there's four different people, four different beings here that I represented. One is God, the other is Satan. They're right across from each other. If you notice, Satan's lower than God. He tried to force himself to be God's equal. There's a lot more going on here today at the cross than just Jesus dying for our sins. That was probably the most important part, but there was also something else going on. Let me read 1 Corinthians 4, 9-2. It says, for I think that God has displayed us, the apostles, last and the men, condemned to death, for we have been made a spectacle to the world, both to angels and to men. You got the angels that did not follow Satan looking down on us. And I can't tell you what they know or what they didn't know, but they know that Jesus was the Son of God. And they know Satan rebelled from heaven. And they see Satan taking the Son of God and crucifying him on the cross. And right there at that moment, it's all coming to prove. You got the accusation that Satan brought against God on his character. In order for God to be a God of love, can't take away the freedom to choose. Each one of you have a choice. You can either choose to love God and serve him because you want to, or you can be a Satan and try to make him a tyrant. And God's not a tyrant. He is a God of love. And these angels, they're persuaded today that through Jesus Christ and through what happened on that cross and how God manifested himself to them, he was proved a God of love that day. I've skipped through a whole lot. And when you look at this timeline, when you look at Genesis 1 and 2 and Ezekiel and Isaiah and Genesis 3, we can spend 6 months on this timeline going through each and every bit of this. When I was first in prison, and God started revealing this to me, it was through a prophecy teacher that we were watching a video on. And he just laid all this out for me. And I understood that God couldn't do away with Satan. He uses the suffering in our lives, the things that Satan uses to destroy us with, God uses us to build us up. God uses it to show you his love, to show you his mercy, God intervened in my life. He showed me the cross. When he called Abraham out of Ur, this was already set in motion. Satan didn't stop. Satan thought he defeated Christ right there that day. But what happened? 3 days later, Christ rose from the grave. And he bridged that gap. Now man has a way to God. God supplied it. God opened the door for it. Satan's judged. He knows he has a short time. He knows his days are short. But God gives each one of us the chance in our lives to prove his character. He's proved it to me. I'm persuaded. I'm one of those, just out of analogy here, I'm one of those angels now. You can't tell me that God's not real. You can't. There isn't many things that you can do in this world that can take God away from you. He can hurt me. He can do to me like he did to Job. He can take me and put me on a cross and crucify me. But there's nothing in this world that can tell me that God ain't real. Because I had an encounter with him. His character was proved in my heart. And that's what he's doing right now, is he's proving his character in your heart. That's his goal for each and every person in this world. He wants to take you off of that bottom line right there. He wants to send you up through the cross of Jesus Christ and pave your way back onto the streets of gold. He wants to bridge the gap for you. Now, I pushed through a lot of this. Last time I did this, it took me an hour to do it. But the main message right there is that red cross. There was so much that got proved that day. When you look at man down there, we're ignorant of what was going on. But when we come and we have an encounter with God, he opens your eyes. He shows you the true condition of your life. The Bible says that there's none of us good. I don't care how good people think they are. Every one of us are in need of a Savior. I don't care what kind of religion you have. Every one of us needs a Savior. Every one of us needs help. When you have an encounter with God, you're no longer ignorant. God opens your heart. Every question that I had before I went to prison, God answered. And you can ask my wife, I have some rough days. I have some days where I still question God. But I promise you, I don't need an answer. Neither will you. The more that you give your heart to Christ, the more you sustain yourself in the Word of God, the more you abide in him, the less you'll need an answer to. And when you look at the cross, Satan was judged. He knows that he's going to be going into the lake of fire. He knows that. God's character was proved. He is a God of love. He is a very patient God. But he is a just God. He is a holy God. And those angels, 2/3 of those angels that didn't fall with Satan, Satan never will. That cross meant more to them about as much as it means to us.